There's something about watching a true crime movie that makes you sit up and pay attention. These are real people and real crimes. But despite their heinous nature, we can't seem to look away, because truth is often much stranger than fiction. We all know the high-profile stories, but there's a whole host of under-the-radar crime stories just waiting to be unearthed. From illegal gambling rings to unsolved mysteries, here are some true crime flicks you may not know about, but should. While most Americans may not be familiar with him, Lee Dusam is notorious in South Korea. In the 1970s, he went from small-time smuggler of gold and diamonds to a wealthy drug lord, becoming one of the top exporters of methamphetamine to Japan in the process. The Drug King is a South Korean crime drama based on his life story. The film stars Song Kang-ho, who's best known to American audiences for his work in films like Snowpiercer and Parasite. Over the course of the film, Dusam goes from family man just trying to provide for his wife and kids to a deeply compromised individual consumed by greed and addiction. Filled with Tarantino-esque humor and stylistic elements reminiscent of Goodfellas or The Departed, The Drug King is a fascinating chronicle of the rise and fall of one of South Korea's most infamous criminals. Meet poker princess Molly Bloom, who ran one of the world's most exclusive high-stakes underground poker games that had Hollywood A-listers betting millions.
Hi.
Hi. I know.
She lived a glamorous life of excess that had her riding high until it all came crashing down. Molly's Game chronicles Bloom's meteoric rise through the ranks of underground gambling to create one of the most powerful empires on the scene. Starring Jessica Chastain, Idris Elba, and Kevin Costner, the biographical crime drama is the directorial debut of Academy Award-winning writer-producer Aaron Sorkin. The film follows Bloom as her dreams of becoming a world-class Olympic skier are crushed by an injury, and she sets out to find a new calling. After moving to Los Angeles, she lands an office job that comes with a side hustle in the lucrative world of illegal gambling. When her boss unceremoniously fires her, she decides to run her own games, where the stakes get higher and higher. While it didn't do big business in theaters, Molly's Game was a critical darling, a true hidden gem. It earned Oscar and Golden Globe nominations for Best Screenplay, and Chastain was nominated for Best Actress at the Golden Globes. The double homicide of a 13-year-old girl and her family's servant has gripped India's attention for years after the two were found murdered inside their home in 2008. The parents were immediately considered suspects, but the case was severely bungled by the police, causing a chaotic investigation that garnered sensational media coverage. Several conclusions have been reached over the years as the case passed from one investigator to the next, but the main assumption is that the parents committed an honor killing, in which one family member kills another because they think the victim has somehow shamed the family. Starring the late Irfan Khan, Guilty views the case from three different law enforcement perspectives. While the film explores several paths of what could have really happened, in reality, the parents were always the main suspects and were eventually arrested and sentenced to life in prison. They later appealed the decision and won, leaving the case unsolved to this day. Convicted murderer Santoya Brown gained national attention in 2017, when multiple celebrities posted on social media about her appeal for clemency after being sentenced to life in prison at just 16 years old. The documentary Murder to Mercy, The Santoya Brown Story, delves into Brown's transformation from a once-troubled teen to prison reform advocate. Accused of killing a 43-year-old man and robbing him, Brown claimed self-defense and lost in court. But amidst the Me Too movement, the hashtag #FreeSantoyaBrown took off and became a rallying cry against child prostitution and what some perceive as a broken criminal justice system. Murder to Mercy dives deep into Brown's life, from her tumultuous upbringing all the way through to her release from prison in 2019, when the governor of Tennessee commuted her sentence after she'd served 15 years in prison. The documentary Roll Red Roll looks to peel back the layers on an alarming case in which members of a Steubenville, Ohio high school football team repeatedly assaulted and raped an underage girl. What ensued was a Boys Will Be Boys cover-up that involved dozens of students, coaches, and faculty. Ultimately, two of the players were charged and sentenced to prison, and several adults were indicted for obstructing justice, tampering with evidence, and lying to a grand jury. While hard to watch, Roll Red Roll is still a must-see, as it carefully reconstructs the night of the crime and delves into the question of why so many people tried to protect the assailants and discredit the victim. racial injustice targeting African Americans has garnered the attention of more Americans in recent years. But this kind of injustice definitely didn't start recently. It's been simmering under the surface of American culture for generations. Strong Island looks to shed light on a case in which a 24-year-old African-American teacher was shot and killed by a white mechanic who was never charged with murder. In 1992, William Ford Jr. went to an auto shop to confront Mark Riley, an employee who was supposed to be repairing a car for Ford. The two had previously gotten into an accident and struck a deal. If Ford didn't file a police report, Riley would repair the wrecked car for him. Frustrated at how long it was taking, one night Ford went to the shop where he was shot dead. Riley was never charged, as he claimed self-defense. But Ford's family believes he was murdered and that justice was not served because of the color of his skin.
There is the growing sense that the DA is going to actually let this kid get away with murder.
Directed by Ford's brother, Strong Island covers a wide swath, from systemic racism to the nuts and bolts of the case. But it's really the story of a grieving family who's never gotten over the loss of their loved one and wants to see seismic cultural change. Filmed in one of Mexico's most notorious penitentiaries, the Spanish-language drama The Fourth Company is based on true events at the Santa Martha prison in Mexico City. Set in the 1970s, The Fourth Company follows a 20-something delinquent named Zambrano who's serving time for car theft. He soon lands a spot on the prison's football team, Los Perros. What he doesn't know is that the team is actually a squad of inmates who serve as enforcers for a corrupt administration within the prison, and commit crimes when given day passes for games. The title of the film is in reference to the prison having three companies of security guards, with the team being the unspoken fourth, doing the dirty work the guards usually can't get away with. Zambrano is thrust into a non-stop loop of violence and crime, taking him down a dark path with seemingly no escape. The Fourth Company is the perfect mix of the classic underdog story and a hard-boiled prison tale. The fact that it's all true only makes it hit harder. Singer Sam Cooke was shot and killed at a cheap Los Angeles motel in 1964 at age 33, after a woman who worked there claimed he threatened her. It's always been an odd tale, with some family, friends, and fans questioning the validity of the details. Remastered, The Two Killings of Sam Cooke digs into conspiracy theories about his untimely and violent death. Cooke died during what many would consider the height of his career, but making popular music wasn't his only talent. He was also a pioneering businessman, as one of the first black performers to own the rights to his music and start his own record label and publishing company, and an outspoken civil rights activist. The Two Killings of Sam Cooke raises multiple questions about why he was killed. Was it because of his activism? Did his manager, Alan Klein, have him murdered so he would be the sole beneficiary of Cooke's music? Or is the official story actually what happened?
There was a sense in the music industry that Sam was getting too powerful and had to be stopped.
Jack Black starring in a true crime movie? Yep. But this isn't an ordinary biographical crime film. This one's a comedy. The story follows Jan Levon, a real-life Polish-American polka band leader who went to jail for running a Ponzi scheme. America is called the land of opportunity, and Levon took full advantage. He came to the United States to pursue his dream of becoming a world-famous polka singer. But when that dream turns out to be harder to achieve than he expected, Levon starts taking investments in the band from his fans. When local law enforcement gets wind of the illegal scheme, an investigator tells Levon that since he isn't properly registered, he must return the money and shut down.
In Poland, everybody do bribes. Do you do bribes?
That's also illegal. No, I do not do bribes.
Me neither do I.
By this point, though, Levon is already in way over his head, having raked in hundreds of thousands of dollars. So instead of closing up shop, he continues down a perilous path from which there is no return. Based on the 2009 documentary The Man Who Would Be Polka King, the comedy takes a lighthearted look at a criminal who defrauded some 400 people out of millions of dollars. Everybody knows the story of notorious 1930s bank robbers Bonnie and Clyde. But what do you know about the men who finally cornered and killed them? The Highwaymen is their story. The period crime drama stars Kevin Costner and Woody Harrelson as two former Texas Rangers tasked with tracking down the murderous duo. And it's not a task to be taken lightly. Bonnie and Clyde offered one of the most garish and spectacular manhunts history has ever seen, earning them celebrity status before the term even existed. Their pictures were splashed on newspapers across America, and their good looks and dapper outfits made them unexpectedly charming to the public. That glamorization was taken to the next level in the 1967 film Bonnie and Clyde. On the flip side, The Highwaymen is a methodical look at what it took to capture the elusive criminals. The main ingredient was dogged persistence by Frank Hamer and Manny Gault, who pursued the pair for months. It took a combination of hard-nosed investigation, gut instinct, and miles of tracking to finally put a stop to Bonnie and Clyde's headline-making crime spree. And The Highwaymen's fresh viewpoint offers a fascinating perspective on a familiar true story. Thanks for watching. Click the links in our video to watch more from Netflix Film Club. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to get the latest exclusive videos. Plus, hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.